everybody. Go ahead and have a seat, please. It's good to see you all here this morning. If you don't know me, my name is Dave Renner. I lead the men's ministry here, and my wife and I also lead a home group with Don and Tommy Lyle, so that's really cool. Did anybody get in here without a bulletin? We got one back there, and he's got one now. Awesome. Thank you. So if you would take a look at this, inside of it, you'll find a lot of sermon notes. You'll also find a connection card. If you would fill that out, and there's a place on there for prayer requests, if you have some prayer requests, and you can put that in the boxes in the back wall here. And on the announcements, there's some information here. And I'd encourage you to read all of the announcements and go through them yourself. We don't have time to go through them all. A couple things I want to point out, though, are if giving, there are some envelopes on the seat backs in front of you. And you can also use those. You can also put those in the box in the back. There's also information for online giving if you prefer to give that way. And just a couple things I'll point out. It looks like 101 membership is today. That's awesome. Vertical marriage class coming up in the big box on the top. If for anybody that's married and or even at that place where they're thinking about getting married, I think that is a great thing to go do. And also, another thing just on the multiple ones here, the Harvest Festival will be coming up end of this month, but it's a big deal. We get to do it in our building this year. It takes a lot of preparation. So that's why we want to talk about it a little bit early. You can contact Nicole Kessler for information about that. I know they need volunteers to make this all happen. And also with that, there's some baskets out there that you can donate candy to for the different groups, home groups and things that are in our church. We kind of have a fun little competition with that. So you feel free to drop them in the Renner home group basket if you'd like to. But anyway, it takes a lot of candy to do this thing for the community, so we would encourage you to pick up some bags of candy and put them in the baskets there. With that, I think that's all we need to talk about here today. I will pray, and we will get on with our service. Dear Heavenly Father, just thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us. Thank you for this opportunity to gather in this beautiful building that you've provided for us. And we just pray, God, that you would work in our hearts today as we worship, as we hear the message, and just pray that we'd hear from you. Pray that we would take what we hear and we would apply it to our lives, God. We just lift up the worship team to you as they lead us. We lift up Gene to you. Just ask you, God, to give him the words for the message. Let him speak it in just a powerful way. And again, let it work in our hearts. Thank you so much, God, for loving us. Thank you for blessing us with so much. Thank you that you seek us out. Thank you that we know you and have a relationship with you and can have a relationship with you. We love you. We praise you, God, and we pray all this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Go ahead and stand with us as we continue.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice to the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes, searched for the light of day. receive it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify.
Bigger, more powerful, and just more amazing than anything going on around us, Lord. And your amazing love has rescued us. You have forgiven us. You take care of us. Our biggest problem is done through you, Lord God. Thank you. Thank you. In your precious name, amen.
I'm forgiven. Because you were forsaken.
Jesus, that you would love us this much. You would go to the cross and die to give us life. That you would invite us into your kingdom. And Lord, you are a good king. And I pray today that our worship, in both in song and in conversations and in the way we engage your word, would bring honor and glory to you. We pray, God, that you would teach us today. Because we need to know your heart and we need to see your, we need to come under your authority and we need your direction, God, as we navigate these trying times that we're walking through right now. And we need to be reminded, Jesus, that everything, that you're bigger than everything and you have authority over everything that happens in our lives. We love you, God, and we just trust you, Jesus, and pray all this in your good, good name. Amen. Good morning. How are you? Good? This is beautiful out there. It's fall, right? Autumn. I like autumn better, don't you? Because I read about fall in Genesis 3, and I'm like, we're not going to call it that. Okay, so if you're new with us today, I'm Gene. Love that I get to serve here as a lead pastor and go to church here. I'm going to invite some of our friends. Jen Ferguson and Melanie Jansen are going to come up and talk to us a little bit about the hospitality team. And they're actually going to warm me up a little bit for the sermon, so I'm excited about that. Here you go.
Good morning. Am I on? Yes, I am. Good morning, church. How's it going? You guys excited to be here on this beautiful Saturday? So nice. Sunday. What day? Where am I? I don't even know where I am. Yeah, thank you. Appreciate that. Okay, so we're going to get a little interactive this morning. Are you guys ready? Come on. Gosh. All right, well, first of all, I'm going to introduce myself. My name is Jen Ferguson. This is my dear friend Melanie Jansen, and we are the greeter team leaders, and I would argue that Miss Melanie, among the millions of other things she does for this church, has the most important job in this church. I apologize, Pastor Gene. So Melanie makes the coffee and makes sure that the donuts get put out every morning. Woo! Love her. So, okay, now it's time for the interactive part. Who sitting in this room, raise your hand if you are currently on a greeter team. Awesome. Thanks, you guys, so much. Yeah, you can put your hands down because I'm done with you now. No, I'm joking. If you are currently on a greeter team, at the end of service, if you would go look at this list and make sure that I have all of your correct information, that would be very helpful. That way I know how to get a hold of you. We're going to put a list together for all the team leaders. Okay, so now for the rest of you that didn't raise your hands, who in here comes to at least one service per month? Okay, keep your hands up. Keep them up. Okay, how many of in here have the, no, you already raised your hand, Jackie. Put your hand down. No, keep your hands up. All right, how many in here have the ability, now this is the ability, not the desire, the ability to smile? Good, keep your hands up. How many in here have the ability to either shake hands, give someone a high five, or a fist bump? Awesome. Okay, well, we're done. You guys go get, I'll get signed up to be greeters because you're qualified. No, but seriously, being a greeter is one of the easiest ways you can serve your church. It's just a really nice way to get to know people. It's only one service per month, and we would really love to have you. We've got people that will train you on what to do, and if you guys have any questions about that, see either myself or Melanie, and then get signed up in the back, and I will see everybody who had their hands up at the end of service get signed up. All right, thanks you.
Got you warmed up. You kind of did your stretches, and we're going to need that this morning because we're tackling 52 verses in Acts. Yeah, you ready? Yeah, but before I do that, you know what? Harvest Festival's coming. Who's excited about Harvest Festival? I love Harvest Festival. Here's what's going to be super cool. First year we get to do it in our building, and we went this week or a couple weeks ago, and we got some bouncy houses of our own, and we're going to set them up in here. So one of them, I just got to tell you a story. I went with Don Ferguson to pick him up. We went to Hamilton, Montana, and one of them's a joust thing where you like hit each other. And Don Ferguson walks out of the shed where the joust game was stored, and he walks out and he's got this big thing in his hand with the, you know, and he's like, "I'm so going to take you down." I'm like, man, these are our new friends, and you're threatening me. So I thought about, we're trying to figure out, what do you think if we set it up during the marriage conference? Huh? Yeah, I think that would be awesome. Hopefully we have enough people that sign up for that marriage conference that we don't have room for it. But I don't know, maybe not. Maybe it's God ordained. But my money's on Charity Cook. If we put John and Charity in there... I mean, John's pretty wiry and quick, but so we'll just leave it at that. So glad that you're here this morning. We've been going through the book of Acts these last few weeks. And what we're doing is we're going through the book in a couple weeks. We've got a couple other guys that are going to preach. And so what we want to see as we go through the book of Acts is we want to see how Jesus is continuing to do his work after he ascended to heaven through his people. So we're looking at the beginning of the church, and it's been so much fun to look through that. And one of the reasons that we want to do it together as a church is we want to be Jesus's church here at Real Life, right? We want, because Jesus says that the gates of hell can't stand against my church. And I got to tell you, right now in the world, the way things seem to be going, it almost looks like the gates of hell are kind of rising up a little bit, right? And so as I've been talking to people and watching social media feeds and listening to conversations that people have, people are kind of afraid right now, and they're wary. Maybe that's a better term. They're wary of what's coming in the future. There are people that are saying, man, I can't wait till 2020 is over. Maybe it'll get easier. There are other people that are afraid that 2020 is going to, or 2021 is going to say to 2020, hold my beer, hold my coffee. This is it's church. But you know what I mean? Like, it's going to get worse. Okay, I've read the back of the book. It's going to get worse before it gets better. But one of the things that we can know as followers of Jesus is that we have a God who goes before us and goes after us. That we have a God who will lead us and guide us, that paves the way for us to follow, that it may be hard because we live in a fallen world. But he's faithful and he's true and he promises he'll never leave us nor forsake us. And so, and he wants to use us to be a light in this world. So we've been going through the book of Acts to look at how his church was established. Because if you want to look at what a pure church looks like, let's look at the first version of it. Okay? And so in Acts 1:8, when we looked at the very beginning of the book, we saw that there's a kind of the hinge, the vision verse of the book of Acts is in Acts 1:8. And Jesus is talking to his disciples before he ascends to heaven. And he says, you're going to receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And when the Holy Spirit comes on you, you'll be my witnesses. He says, in Jerusalem and in Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. So we've been talking about what it means for us to be witnesses of Jesus, witnesses for Jesus in 2020. We've talked about how it starts in your home. How many in here have kids? Okay. Right, your primary mission as your kids' parents isn't to educate them and make sure they graduate and get good jobs. It's to raise them in a way where they can see Jesus, where you share the gospel with your kids, right? Disciple them. And then it goes to starts in your home, starts in your marriage. My wife and I are constantly reminding each other of the gospel. We're constantly reminding each other that we're not defined by our actions or how awesome our marriage is, but we're defined by what Jesus has done and what Jesus says about us. We're constantly trying to cast vision into our kids' lives for who Jesus has called them to, that my daughter's beauty isn't based on how tall she is or what her weight looks like, but that she's created in the image of God, and God has created her as a masterpiece in Christ Jesus. That my son, wherever he goes and lives, right, God goes with him. He can be strong and courageous because God's with him. Right? My daughter's a school teacher, so she can be strong and courageous as God goes with her. right? And it goes to where we recreate. It goes to where we work, right? It goes to all of those different areas of our life. It even goes to Vegas. It's kind of funny. In fact, we got to see an example of that. We've been this weekend, last weekend and this weekend, I think there's been 5 baptisms here at Real Life. And last Sunday after the 11 o'clock service, Ryan Stice, who's one of our middle school boys youth leaders, got to baptize Keegan, who's one of the guys in his small group. And Ryan has been discipling Keegan for a couple of years now. And so I think we got a quick video to show you that baptism so we can celebrate with him.
And do you commit to serve him for the rest of your life? Okay, so unplug your nose.
So.
All right. So,
in the name of the Father, and the Son,
and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I baptize you. Welcome your life in Jesus, all right?
Cool. Those are the same baptisms, just like Acts chapter 2, when 3,000 people were baptized in one day, right? That mission that Jesus has called us to, reaching the world for him one person at a time, is continuing today. And lives and generations are being changed. That's just so good to see that the Bible lived out in front of us. And I love how that's happening all over the place in this church. So we're gonna tackle Acts chapter 13 today. So I hope you had your coffee and you're ready to roll. And this is an interesting chapter in the book of Acts. So here's what we've been looking at so far. The gospel's been spreading. It starts in Jerusalem. And then we see it start going to other places, to other people. We saw it go to Syria. Here recently we saw a Gentile, Cornelius, okay, who the Jews would think, you have no part of God. Because us Jews are God's chosen people, you Gentiles, yeah, you're not. And then Cornelius is this guy who invites Peter to share the gospel with him. And Peter, in fact, when Cornelius becomes a Christian and Peter shares the gospel with him, as we saw in Acts 15, so you can read that if you're new at this, we've already covered it. He gets kind of criticized for, what are you doing sharing the gospel, the good news about God with these Gentiles? And what Peter tells them is it's always been the plan, God's plan from the very beginning, is that all people from all nations would come to know Jesus. So we saw that. Now what we're going to see is that Saul is going to go into these towns, and he kind of follows his normal pattern of going to the Jews first. First of all, those are his brothers, and he wants them to know Jesus, right? Anyone got people close to you that you want to know Jesus? And so you're going to go to them first, right? But then they're going to you'll see, they're going to reject Jesus. And he's like, okay, from here on out, I'm going to go to the Gentiles, right? It's open for everybody, which I'm super glad about, being a Gentile myself, right? So we're going to dive in Acts chapter 13. Now in the church of Antioch, there were prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch and Saul. So we got this church. These guys are prophets and teachers in the church. I just want to take a moment and talk about church leadership for just a moment. I want you to see the plurality and the diversity of the leaders in this church. Okay, so it's a reason why I'm not the only leader in the church. I serve and submitted to a team of elders here at Real Life. And our elders are pretty diverse. Some would say odd. In their grouping, they're not all the same. They have different backgrounds, different opinions, right? But we come together and we serve this church as elders. So we see these guys and we see how different they are. Barnabas is from Cyprus. Simeon is potentially from Nigeria. Lucius from Cyrene. Manaen, this guy I like. It says he was brought up with Herod. He was actually raised with King Herod, who persecuted Jesus. And so what they say is it's possible he could have been his foster brother. So what I think is interesting is while Jesus is being tried before King Herod, this Manaen guy is watching all of this happen, and he becomes a follower of Jesus. Because what we know about these guys is they're unschooled, ordinary men, as Acts chapter 3 says, but they'd been with Jesus, right? God doesn't always, like, call the Bible scholars, right? He calls unschooled, ordinary people who walk with Jesus, who are submitted to Jesus, who love Jesus, and then he qualifies them to be who he's created them to be. We see that happening here. Verse 2, while they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. So let's talk about fasting for just a moment, because it's something that we don't talk about a lot unless it's in the form of a conversation about diets. Okay, fasting was, we've talked here quite a bit about spiritual practices or spiritual disciplines. And spiritual disciplines are things that you practice to get you in a place to hear from God, to get you closer to God, get you more focused on God. And there's so much noise in the world right now, we have to intentionally, I think, put ourselves in a place to be still and know that God's God, right? And so we've talked about it. We talk about Bible script, Bible reading, scripture memorization, meditating on the scripture, prayer, serving, giving, worship. Fasting is another one. And the whole point of fasting and the way it's been classically practiced is people would give up everything except maybe water. And they would, some would do a complete fast up to 40 days, some longer. And it would, they would take that time they would be eating, and they would even take that discomfort and they would use it to focus on something that God's put on their mind or focus on God himself. And so what's interesting is the practice of fasting in the church for spiritual reasons was consistently practiced until probably, and I think it was like the 15 or 1600s, and then it started changing. And it's because we don't, man, I go without a meal, I think I'm going to starve, right? And so it's interesting how these things have worked. Now, we've taken that practice and turned it into, it makes us feel we can lose weight if we do it. But the point here is that they're focused on God. Now, the other thing I want you to see is the Holy Spirit calls these Barnabas and Saul into another ministry. It's God at work. It doesn't look like the elders got together and says, man, we need someone to go reach the Gentiles. Who are we going to pick? Well, let's look at the resumes. They were praying and fasting, and the Holy Spirit said, send these guys. Now, how did the Holy Spirit talk? Was it an audible voice? I don't know. It doesn't look that way. Maybe. You know, what was it? Did he write something in the sky? Was it in there, you know, in this? I don't know. But oftentimes the way it works, it appears, is that as you're reading the Word of God, as you're seeking God, he just puts things on your heart and even sets up circumstances, right? And here's what's interesting here. If we go to verse 3, it says, so after they had fasted and prayed, they, the church, placed their hands on them and sent them off. So there's this idea here that as God is, the Holy Spirit is saying, set aside Saul and Barnabas for this new work. By the way, Saul and Barnabas were already serving. As we look through the book of Acts, I want you to see that, because sometimes we get to this place, I know I need to serve, but I got to find the exact perfect place to serve. And then I'll step into it. I just want you to know there's not always exact perfect places for you to serve. Right? So they were serving, and then God said, now I've got something else for them. When we planted this church in 2007, we actually started, my wife and I started leading a small group, a home group. And we were leading a home group. And then in 2004, I was asked to step in as a small groups pastor at Real Life Ministries Post Falls. And I have to tell you, the call to ministry to me, to full-time ministry, wasn't the way I expected it. I thought when I would get that call, it would be like the opening line to The Simpsons. You remember, The Simpsons? Anybody remember that? Some of you are like, my mom didn't let me watch it. Oh, okay. I mentioned beer and The Simpsons. I'm not doing real well this morning, am I? But the way I was called to ministry is I was actually serving as a home group leader, and I had a men's group that I was leading at my house. And then I was at a men's retreat, and Brandon Gidden, who was the guy in charge of all of the small groups at Real Life Post Falls, that church was growing really fast then, that he invited me to go for a walk. So we got our paper plates and we're eating eggs and we're eating bacon and we're out on a trail. And he's like, hey, we want you to pray about coming on staff to be a small group leader. He looks at me, he's got eggs in his teeth. And I'm like, I didn't think it would be this way, right? And initially I told him no, but throughout some other things that happened, I ended up saying yes. They told me how much pastors made, and I was like, ah, can't do that. But God worked it all out, and it's been good. He's been faithful. But when it was time to come here, I was already serving as small group pastor there, and I really liked it because I didn't have to preach. I was like, this is awesome. And then it looked like God was doing some things here, so they asked us to pray about coming over here. And they were asking a lot of people to pray about coming over here, actually. And a lot of guys were like, no, I don't want to go to the Silver Valley. And as my wife and I drove through the valley on our way back from Montana, because I thought we were actually going to go to Montana to be a part of a church, God broke our heart for the Silver Valley. And when we went back to Real Life Post Falls and told them, I think God's leading us to go there, they laid hands on, I don't know if Christy was part of that. The elders laid hands on me and said, man, I just need to pray for you as you're going to go do a part of that. And what they're saying is we agree with God about what's happening here. That's what they're doing there. We agree with God that you're going to go. They're not saying we agree that it's going to be successful. Do you hear me? They're just saying, we agree in this next step. So we're going to pray for you. And what they're saying is we're going to pray for you. We're going to pray with you. And we're going to do whatever we can to help support what God's doing here. We do that here. But it's going to have some bumps. Ministry has bumps. And it's okay. But we're with you. So that's what's happening here. The two of them, verse 4, sent on their way by the Holy Spirit, went down to Seleucia and sailed from there to Cyprus. So when you look at this new work starting, why Cyprus? Barnabas is from Cyprus. He's going to go tell his friends about this Jesus. When they arrived at Salamis, verse 5, they proclaimed the word of God in the Jewish synagogues. John was with them as their helper. So what you see here is this pattern that's going to be, it's been established in the book of Acts and will continue, that they go to the Jews first. Why? Because those are God's called people, right? God's chosen people. Plus, if I go to the synagogue, I know these people are already familiar with the scriptures. So that seems like it's going to be the easiest group of people to tell about Jesus. Would you agree? Okay, so it's just like, man, let's go there first. They've got John Mark, who's Barnabas' cousin. It says he comes along at the helper. What I love about that is we're going to see him mentioned a couple times in this passage. He doesn't get a lot of credit. He's there doing whatever they tell him to do. But I want you to see John Mark in this part of the scripture is as important as Saul and Barnabas. Okay, necessary. Verse 6, they traveled through the whole island until they came to Paphos. There they met a Jewish sorcerer and false prophet named Bar-Jesus, who was an attendant of the proconsul Sergius Paulus. The proconsul, an intelligent man, sent for Barnabas and Saul because he wanted to hear the word of God. Okay, Bar-Jesus is a Hebrew name, and it means son of Jesus. And in Hebrew culture, to call yourself son of Jesus would mean you're a follower of Jesus. But here it says he's a false prophet. And so this is something that started then that continues today. And a false prophet is someone who says they're a follower of Jesus, but they teach things that are not true of Jesus according to the scriptures. So we see this happening today. And so I just want to put this in because there are so many different false prophets out there today. Mormonism and Jehovah's Witnesses, these are easy ones to look at and say they come in the name of Jesus, but they teach things about Jesus that don't line up with what the revealed word of God says. But there's other groups. Or other people. There are people that will tell you that there must be many ways to heaven because we're all created uniquely. But Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. There are people that tell you that everybody gets to go to heaven because love wins. And God doesn't want to send anyone to hell. Well, I would agree that God probably doesn't want to send anyone to hell. That's why he sent his son Jesus to die on a cross for the forgiveness of our sins. But the Bible makes it clear, unless we come to Jesus and receive him as Savior and Lord and receive his sacrifice for the forgiveness of our sins, we're going to go to hell unless we receive Jesus. And it doesn't mean God doesn't love. It says God so loved the world that he sent his son, Jesus. Does this make sense to you this morning? So what's happening is we've got this weird thing today. Well, we can't say they're false prophets because it'll hurt their feelings. And I understand that. And so we have to test our heart. We don't. I mean, 2020 is the year of the jacked up heart. That like we like to get mad at people and get mean at people. But man, we don't talk about this stuff saying, hey, we're better than they are. Because we know it's only because of God's grace that Jesus was revealed to us. But we do these things because it's truth and it's important. It's important. I love my kids. Because I love my kids, I'm going to tell them the truth about Jesus. I'm going to tell them the truth about the other prophets, the other voices they may be listening to. Does it make sense to you? And look what happens here. So the proconsul, he's the highest leader that Rome ruled Cyprus at this time. So the proconsul is the highest government Roman leader in Cyprus at the time. So he wants to hear the word of God. Verse 8, Elymas, the sorcerer. So Elymas is Bar-Jesus' Greek name. Okay, same guy. It's his Greek name. The sorcerer. A sorcerer meant they would like look to the stars and look to the heavens. And some would even claim that they could foretell the future. He opposed them and tried to turn the proconsul from the faith. So I want you to see what's going on here. This is the sorcerer is probably driven by his pocketbook, because if the proconsul becomes a follower of Jesus, he's going to find out that I'm not working for Jesus, okay? But this is a spiritual battle that's going on for the proconsul's soul. This isn't about Saul and Barnabas and Bar-Jesus. This is a way bigger issue than who's got the proconsul's ear. This is an eternal issue, a spiritual battle that's going on. So then Saul, who is also called Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, looked straight at Elymas and said, okay, two things. Paul is Saul's a Hebrew name. Paul is his Greek name. And what we're going to see is because Paul's going to start preaching to the Gentiles from here out, his name's going to change here, okay? But I also want you to see it says he's full of the Holy Spirit. It means he's not full of hate. It means he's not full of malice. It means that somehow, because the Holy Spirit's working in Paul's life, he understands this isn't about me and Bar-Jesus. This is a bigger issue, okay? And those bigger issues are fought in particular. We have to fight Jesus' fights Jesus' way. Okay? So, but look what he does here. He's talking to Bar-Jesus. He says, you're a child of the devil and an enemy of everything that is right. That's a little different than saying, oh, you just need a hug. You're full of all kinds of deceit and trickery. Will you never stop perverting the right ways of the Lord? Paul's calling out evil. Okay, you're working for the other guy. Verse 11, now the hand of the Lord is against you. You're going to be blind for a time, not even able to see the light of the sun. Immediately, mist and darkness came over him, and he groped about, seeing someone lead him by the hand. So this is a huge turning point for Paul. Not only does his name change, but now he's stepping into the role of an apostle. So an apostle has this authority. I think Paul's authority, not only was it to plant churches, but it was to establish the very bedrock of the theology of the church, because that's what's going on here. And so he's like, okay, you're evil. You're going to be blind, which I find interesting, because isn't that what Jesus did to Paul? He made him blind, right? And then the Holy Spirit comes in and bam, the guy becomes blind. Right? This is him stepping into that role of an apostle. It's kind of like Peter with Ananias and Sapphira, if you went through that passage with us, where Peter says, what are you doing? You've lied to the Holy Spirit, right? And the guy ends up dying. That's Peter's expression, his authority as an apostle. This is Paul stepping into that same role. You with me so far? Okay. Look at this, verse 12. When the proconsul saw what has happened, he believed. Okay, now the miracle did that, but I want you to see what he believed. For he was amazed at the teaching of the Lord. It doesn't say he was amazed that this guy became blind. He was amazed at the teaching of the Lord. And I was praying about this morning, is just getting ready for this morning's sermon. And one of the things that really hit me is, you know, we talk here all the time. That in our conversations with people, I have a part to play in the conversation. That person has a part to play in the conversation. I can't do their part. But God's got his part to play in the conversation too, right? We call it my part, their part, God's part. Okay? Now, we get to partner with God at people coming to know Jesus. Do you believe that God was at work in the proconsul's life? Yeah, and he even blinded a guy, right? Do you believe God's at work in the conversations you have today? Absolutely. And I love that picture. Now, he may not blind people in the conversations that you have, or he may. God can do whatever he wants. But as we're working in these conversations, we've got this game changer who's working behind the scenes or sometimes right in front of everything, and his name's God. And he is faithful and he is true and he loves that person you're talking to more than you do. I love that. Okay, verse 13. By the way, people are still amazed at the teaching about the Lord, just so you know. Verse 13, from Paphos, Paul and his companions. So you see Paul's listed first now because he stepped into the authority as an apostle. So they're going to start all the way through scripture now. You're going to see Paul listed first as a testament to his authority. He sails to Perga and Pamphylia, where John Mark left them. John left them to return to Jerusalem. We don't know why John left. Some people say, well, he was probably homesick. Some people say, well, he was Barnabas' cousin and didn't like the fact that Paul's in charge now. One of the things we hear later in Scripture is Paul's not happy about him leaving and won't take him on a trip in the future because he's like, that guy's weak toast. I don't want anything to do with that guy. But one of the cool things that we see is toward the end of Paul's life, Paul says, bring John Mark to me because he's been helpful in my ministry. We see reconciliation. It takes a while, but we see it throughout the testimony of Scripture. Verse 14, from Pergatha down to Pisidian Antioch on the Sabbath, they entered the synagogue and sat down. After reading from the law and the prophets, the leaders of the synagogue sent word to them saying, brothers, if you have a word of exhortation for the people, please speak. So he's going to the Jews first. Those are the people, and it's Paul's habit. Those are my brothers. I want them to know Jesus more than anything. And Paul talks about in Romans 9 also. Now, standing up, Paul motioned with his hand and said, fellow Israelites and you Gentiles who worship God, listen to me. I'm going to starting sermons here. Listen up! God's got something to say. Right? Now, here's what's going to happen. He's going to preach a sermon, much like the sermons that we've seen in the book of Acts so far. We saw one in Acts 2. We've seen Peter do it twice. We saw Stephen do it. And he's telling the Israelites about their past and how faithful God has been in their past. If you guys were at the men's breakfast yesterday, you heard John Cook talk about spiritual markers. Okay, and we talk about spiritual markers a lot here. And spiritual markers are those things that God, that you remember. And so I encourage people to keep a list of them. Those places in your life where God showed up. Okay? So Christy and I have a whole, those boys I told you about that broke our hearts for the Silver Valley. Those are spiritual markers in our lives. Those are places where God showed up. Okay? What he's going to do is he's going to tell the people of Israel, in your past history, these are places that God has shown up. He's been faithful and true to your people. You have strayed, you have whined, you have complained, You have fought against God. He has been patient. He has been kind. He has sustained you, and he has sent someone to give you forgiveness of your sins. Okay? So we're just going to race through this sermon. The God of the people of Israel chose our ancestors. He made the people prosper during their stay in Egypt. With mighty power, he led them out of that country. For about 40 years, he endured their conduct in the wilderness, and he overthrew seven nations in Canaan, giving their land to his people as their inheritance. All this took about 450 years. So 400 years slavery, 40 years wandered in the desert, about 10 years to take the land. Then the people asked for a king, and he gave them Saul, son of Kish, which, by the way, meant they were rejecting God as their king, of the tribe of Benjamin, who ruled 40 years. After removing Saul, he made David their king. God testified concerning him, "I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will do everything I want him to do." From this man's descendants, God has brought Israel the Savior Jesus, as he promised. Before the coming of Jesus, John preached repentance and baptism to all the people of Israel. As John was completing his work, he said, "Who do you suppose that I am? I'm not the one you're looking for, but there is one coming after me whose sandals I'm not worthy to tie. Fellow children of Abraham and you God-fearing Gentiles, it is to us that this message of salvation has been sent. The people of Jerusalem and their rulers did not recognize Jesus. Yet in condemning him, they fulfilled the words of the prophet that are read every Sabbath. Though they found no proper ground for a death sentence, they asked Pilate to have him executed. When they had carried out all that was written about him, they took him down from the cross and laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead. And for many days he was seen by those who had traveled with him from Galilee to Jerusalem. They're now his witnesses to our people. We tell you the good news. What God promised our ancestors, he's fulfilled for us. Their children, by raising up Jesus, as it's written in the second Psalm, 'You're my son, today I've become your father.' God raised him from the dead so that he will never be subject to decay. As God has said, 'I will give you the holy and sure blessings promised to David.' So it is stated also elsewhere, 'You will not let your Holy One see decay.' Now when David served God's purpose in his own generation, he fell asleep. He was buried with his ancestors, and his body decayed. But the one whom God raised from the dead did not see decay. Jesus is alive." Right? This is what he says. So he's like, Israel, he's been patient with you from the beginning. He's been kind to you from the beginning. He hasn't stopped. Right? You even killed his son, Jesus, and he raised him from the dead to give you a second chance at receiving salvation. Right? He's still putting up with you. He's still patient with you. And then there, verse 38, here's what he says. Okay, because of all of that, therefore, my friends, I want you to know that through Jesus, the forgiveness of sins is proclaimed to you. Okay? Through him, through Jesus, everyone, I studied that word out, means every person, including you and me, everyone who believes is set free from every sin, a justification you were not able to obtain under the law of Moses. So he's saying, you've been trying to follow the law. When Moses gave us the law from the Mount of Sinai, we've been trying to follow it, 613 laws, but all following the law showed us is we can't follow the law. Right? Some of us broke the law today. Okay? And so what he's saying, though, is when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, we don't have to earn our salvation. We receive our salvation. Jesus earned our salvation for us on the cross. And we just come to him and we submit to him and say, Jesus, I'm a sinner and I'm in need of a Savior. Will you forgive me of my sin? Jesus, I want to follow you. And he brings us, leads us in repentance, which means a change of mind. I'm no longer the captain of my ship. Jesus is. And I'm going to follow him. Does it mean we do it perfectly? No. Is anyone in here perfect? Not one, but Jesus is, and he changes us, right? Now here's what I love, and he says, a justification you were not able to obtain, and I love what Romans 8 says, so we're going to shift gears for just a second, because I love how Romans 8:1 starts, so now there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. Thank you. That's so good. Because I know some of you woke up maybe feeling condemned today. And so here's what, and you may find yourself where you go through seasons of that. I do. Especially in the wintertime in the Silver Valley. I struggle with that. And I just get to these places and then I start listening to those voices. The body and the mind and the spirit kind of work together. And I start listening to those voices. Remember those things you did, Gene? There's still times that Christy cries that I wonder if it's because of something I've done to her. And I need to be reminded constantly, there's no condemnation for those who belong to Christ Jesus. And because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. So God did what the law could not do. He sent his own son in a body like the bodies we sinners have. And in that body, God declared an end to sin's control over us by giving his son as a sacrifice for our sins. He did this so that the just requirement of the law would be fully satisfied for us who no longer follow our sinful nature but instead follow the Spirit. And Christ's righteousness is imputed, given to us. And God looks at you. When he looks at you, he's not disappointed. He's not remembering your sins. He's looking at you through the perfection of Jesus Christ, saying, that's my son, that's my daughter. And he started a good work in you, and he'll be faithful to complete that work. And it's so, does anyone have a hard time believing this? Like me. I've had conversations where people are like, I don't deserve this. I know. But it points to the goodness of our God. And we have to see that. This is not based on us. It's based on God and his goodness. And I want you to see this other part is that he's the one that starts the conversation with you. He's the one that pursues you. You just need to hear that. And so here's what he says in verse 40. Take care what the prophets have said does not happen to you. Look, you scoffers who wonder and perish. For I'm going to do something in your days that you would never believe even if someone told you. So he's quoting Habakkuk. And he's telling Israel way back then that he's going to raise up the Chaldeans to discipline them unless they change their ways. But they wouldn't listen to him. And so he raised up the Chaldeans to discipline them. And Paul's telling them, I don't want you to be like those guys in Habakkuk's day. When you hear the message of the gospel, I don't want you to not listen. I want you to listen and to respond. See, that's what he's saying. But you have to understand, he's talking to his friends. He's like, I love you guys. There's no pride in any of this. Paul's one of the most humble men in Scripture, I think, that he says, I'm the chief sinner. I don't deserve to know Jesus. And he's like, man, I love what, I think it's Luther that says this. It's one beggar telling another beggar where to find bread. I love that, right? And it says, verse 42, as Paul and Barnabas were leaving the synagogue, the people invited them to speak further about these things on the next Sabbath. Verse 43, when the congregation was dismissed, many of the Jews and devout converts to Judaism followed Paul and Barnabas, who talked with them and urged them to continue in the grace of God. On the next Sabbath, almost the whole city gathered to hear the word of the Lord. Verse 45, when the Jews saw the crowds, they were filled with jealousy. One of the reasons, and I just want to just put this out there, one of the reasons might be that the Jews are looking around at these unwashed people around them, and they're like, why are you here? Who told you about this good news about God? We're God's chosen people. There's like a spiritual pride that could be coming out. And man, this comes out today, doesn't it? Who told you to move to North Idaho? I mean, there's this thing that we struggle with. And so this might be what's going on here. It says they were filled with jealousy. They began to contradict what Paul was saying and heaped abuse on him. Then Paul and Barnabas answered them boldly. We had to speak the word of God to you first because Jesus came from the Jews and they were sent to the Jews first. He goes, since you reject it and do not consider yourselves worthy of eternal life, we now turn to the Gentiles. He says, you do not consider yourself worthy of eternal life. So they chose to remain separated from God. They chose to remain under the the control and dominion of sin. They chose to remain what Jesus would say, lost. But it wasn't, you got to see, I don't think it's a lack of God's effort, because as we just saw in the sermon, God did everything to sustain them to this point. He even sent Barnabas and Saul to their synagogue to preach the gospel to them, right? So it's not God that's not able to do this, but they're the ones that are rejecting him. And I was thinking, there's two groups of people in here this morning. There are those that find yourself in that place where God has been so faithful in your life, and he's cared for you, and he sustained you, and he's even brought you into church to hear the gospel. But you're either determining this morning that you can't trust him or you're not worthy of eternal life. So you may find yourself in that place, or you may find yourself in a place. The other group, I think, is in a place where you've accepted Jesus. And I think the message for you today in that sermon is you need to be reminded that God doesn't abandon his people. That no matter what 2020 or 2021 brings, God says, I'm with you and I'll never leave you nor forsake you. In fact, I'm going to use you. Before the beginning of time, I had good works planned for you, and I'm going to use you to complete those good works, because no one can stand against me. And then it goes on here, verse 47. For this is what the Lord commanded us. I have made you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring salvation to the ends of the earth. When the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and honored the word of the Lord. And all who were appointed for eternal life believed. All who received God's grace believed. The word of the Lord spread through the whole region. But the Jewish leaders incited the God-fearing women of high standing and the leading men of the city. They stirred up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them from their region. Verse 51, so they shook the dust off their feet as a warning to them and went to Iconium, and the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. So a couple things there. They shook the dust off their feet. It's a saying that in that passage, the way I understand it, is that the disciples of Jesus were shaking the dust off their feet, saying, these people have rejected the gospel. So it's almost a judgment on them, okay? It didn't mean that they just disagreed with them about some stuff. And so as we talk about the fact that we have to do Jesus' things Jesus' way, okay? There's some hard stuff we're going to walk through potentially these next couple years, church. There just is. You're not going to get your way. There's going to be people that disagree with you. There may even be a time of persecution that we may experience in our lifetime, okay? But we have to be reminded that this isn't a battle between us and another person. There's a spiritual battle going on in the heavenly realms that was established before you and I ever walked the earth, okay? This battle is bigger than bigger than parties, political parties. It's bigger than nations. It's bigger than families, right? There is a battle against good and evil. And so, as followers of Jesus, first of all, we need to be able to discern what's good and evil, and the Word of God is what gives us that discernment. So I'm constantly encouraging you, sometimes even yelling at you, to read the Word of God so that you can hear the voice of God, so you can discern good from evil, because there are false prophets out there and they will deceive you. And it's hard. I mean, it says that in the end times, even the elect may be deceived, right? It's tricky. So we do that, but we also have to remember that we have to fight Jesus's battles Jesus's way. And I don't know that, cussing at people or writing them off in your life because they don't agree with you, I don't know if that's the way it's done. You know, when Jesus went to the cross in 1 Peter chapter 2, it says that when he went to the cross, I want you to think about this, the very people that he was dying for were the people nailing him to the cross. They were the people cussing at him, the people mocking him. And it says in 1 Peter 2 that believers, Jesus left an example that you should follow in his steps. And it says that when he was on the cross, that he didn't yell back at them. He didn't fight them. It says instead he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He was trusting God. Now, it doesn't mean that we slink away from evil. It means that we have to step up and do our part, because evil can thrive when good men do nothing, right? But we have to be careful how we do it. How we walk this out matters. And I was just thinking about this too in 1 Peter 3. We're just going to end with this. I'm just going to let this verse wash over you as it has been with me this week. But in your hearts, 1 Peter 3:15, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience so that those who speak maliciously against your good behavior in Christ, and they will, but those who do it may be ashamed of their slander. Because we don't know what God's doing in the background. But he hasn't turned his back on us. He's not like, oh, I didn't see 2020 coming. Oh, I didn't see this election coming. God's at work in all of this stuff. And he's calling us, Christians, to live in, to walk in the footsteps of Jesus as we live in this dark world. Because when the world gets darker, the light of Jesus gets brighter. And I got to tell you, it means I spend a lot of time like this. Right? I don't know how many times I hit delete on my computer because I got something to say. And so I'm trying to learn how to say the things that are helpful, but I'm also trying to learn how to shut my mouth in the things that aren't helpful. So I'm going to ask, Dave's going to come up and lead us through communion. As he does that, I just got a couple implications down here that I want you to look at. I just want to look at a couple of them. First of all, reaching the world for Jesus, one person at a time, it's the main thing for our church. The gospel, it's the main thing. Don't get high-centered. Don't get distracted. There's lots of other things you can be involved with. But the number one thing, right, Harvest Festival. Reason we do Harvest Festival is it gives us an opportunity, first of all, to let our community have some fun in a safe place. But we want to be able to give them a reason for the hope that we have. And we're going to do it in gentleness, we're going to do it in respect, and we're going to do it with candy. Right? Every person, I loved watching you respond to Jen this morning, Jen and Melanie, when she was talking about greeters and watching you smile. I got to be done, but I got to tell you a real quick story. Sorry, Dave. Super quick story. A friend of mine, we had some German church planters here this week. And they wanted to talk about you. And they wanted to hear about what God was doing in this church, because what God is doing here, they want to take some of the things that's happening here and replicate that in Germany. People loving God and loving each other and disciples being made. So they were talking, they were meeting with me. So there were some German church planters. There was a guy named Dave who is in charge of the mission program in the Real Life family. There was also another guy named Paul. And I had forgotten who Paul was. He was just this guy that was staring at me while I was being interviewed. And in my testimony, when I talk to church people, in my testimony, one of the things I tell them about is when Christy and I had been separated for 4 months, we went to this church called Real Life. And in this church, the first week I was there, there was a guy that asked me my name. His name was Dean. And the next week when I went back, he remembered my name. And that had never happened before in a church. And I knew that moment, that was our church. I knew that moment I mattered. It wasn't the preaching. It was a guy named Dean. What I forgot about was Paul was Dean's son. And Dean passed away about a year ago. And Paul stopped me after that meeting and said, Gene, I have to tell you, I've talked to a ton of people since my dad passed away who told me my dad changed their lives. He goes, but here's the thing. He wasn't a preacher. He wasn't a flat, he was a carpet salesman. But he was real and he loved people. That's one of the reasons I think, like, our greeting team here is one of the most important teams that we have here in the church. Because you may never want to get on stage and preach, but can you be real? And can you love people? That changes everything. Changes everything. I'm going to pray for us, and then Dave's going to lead us through communion. Father God, thanks. I just thank you, Lord, at how you just use normal people. Unschooled, ordinary people that have been with you. People with backgrounds that aren't always good. People with insecurities, people with struggles. And you use them, God, to preach the good news of Jesus across the world, to change lives and to change generations. And God, I'm grateful for just a normal guy like Dean, who was just humble, who struggled, but who was willing to reach out to someone, to shake his hand, to remember his name, and to let him know he mattered. Thank you for how that happens every day here at Real Life. Not only on the weekends, but through the soup connection and homework hubs and youth groups, and benevolence ministries, and in our thrift store. And God, you are faithful as you just love people through people. Thanks for being good to us, Jesus. And we pray this in your name. Amen.
Thank you, Jim. I'm going to lead us through communion, and in just a minute, I'll ask the servers to start passing out the communion elements. At Real Life, we do communion at every service after the service. Well, sometimes before, but we do communion at every service. And we invite you, if you are a believer, to join us in that, even if you just became a believer while you were hearing this message. We do invite you to join us. So the servers, go ahead. Can start passing out the elements, and when they come by, if you want, take them and join us in this. If you're not comfortable with it, you can just let it pass by. And if you would hold them in your hands until we all get served, then we will take them together. While they're passing them out, I'd like to read a scripture to you. I see these little things in the Bible all the time, just to remind, they remind me, they should remind us of exactly what took place on the cross and what Jesus has done for us. This scripture is in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and I'll start at 16, and it says, so from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old has gone. The new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. And then verse 19, it says that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. I want to read that again. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against him. And that's what we're remembering here today, and that's what we're celebrating here today. It was God that pursued us, and it was God that paid the penalty for our sin, and it was God that saved us. So before we take the elements, we take a little bit of time for prayer. So if you would join us in this, and we try to start out with just confessing our sins. So if you have any sins that need confessing, let's just take a minute in the quietness of your heart, bow your heads, and let's ask God to forgive us. And then if you would, take a minute and pray for the lost or the hurting. So just think of the people in your life that you know that are lost and those that might be hurting. And let's pray for them. Lastly, if you would, let's pray for the church, for this church, for the other Christian churches in the Silver Valley, and for Jesus' church around the world. In 1 Corinthians, Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Let's take the bread together. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's take the juice. "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's pray. Oh, Father, thank you that you seek us, God. Thank you that you pursue us and that you don't give up on us. And you make every effort possible to try to develop a relationship with us, God. Thank you for the salvation that you give us, for the completed work that Jesus did on the cross, where the price was paid for our sins, Lord. Thank you that we can have a relationship with you, that we can talk to you, that we can gather in your name, we can be your people. We can proclaim your goodness and your love. We praise you, God. We love you. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. The worship team is going to lead us in a final song, and there'll be some people up front here if you would like to have someone pray with you.
Go ahead and stand with us as we start. I see his body breaking. I see his fingers bleed. I see the darkness tremble at the ground below his feet. And in the darkest hours, they're on Calvary. He was seemingly broken beautifully, broken beautifully. Come down to the waters, come let the broken sing. Come on, sons and daughters, his love changes everything. Come when the fear is fighting, to find in the risen King. And when the heavens opened, I saw the sins of man become a crown of glory as you died and rose again. Thank you.
Like you have to be a part of the greeting team to love people here. That is not true. We love as we're loved, right? And you are loved by God. You have to know that today more than you know anything, is that God loves you, and as He loves you, you get to love others. This should be the friendliest place in the world. Disneyland should have nothing on us. Right? Because we have Jesus. We have Jesus. Let's pray. Father God, thanks so much for loving us. Your love changes everything. And I pray, God, that we walk as changed people. And Lord, that you would teach us to love the way that we're loved. You are good and you are faithful. And we praise you today. And God's people said, amen. I love you, church. God bless you. Say hey to someone.